Thanks, Eric. And thank you all for coming and having me here. So today I'm gonna talk a little bit about artificial life, and in particular how I've been using it over the years to understand the origins of biological complexity, and just in general, how evolution is such a powerful dynamic process. And I'm coming from Michigan State University, and I'm one of the PIs on the Beacon Center for the Study of Evolution in Action. I just wanted to give a call out to Beacon at the beginning. So Beacon is an NSF Science and Technology Center. We're actually across five different universities. So in addition to Michigan State, there's University of Texas Austin, North Carolina A&T, University of Washington, and University of Idaho. And we're a large, very multidisciplinary group all trying to understand how evolution works as a dynamic ongoing process. And so a lot of the work I'll be talking about is in conjunction with various collaborators throughout Beacon and actually beyond. I'd like to start a little bit by talking about my own thought process in terms of how I got into this line of work. And I was actually originally focused on computer science, very interested in artificial intelligence, and excited about all of the prospects of artificial intelligence. But the more I learned about the field, the more I realized that real human level AI was still 5 to 10 years away. This was back in the 90s. Just like it had always been, and just like it still is today, but now for real, 5 to 10 years, we're gonna have it. It's just been this sliding window. And as I thought more about how I would approach these sorts of problems, I started learning a lot more about how natural intelligence works, and where natural intelligence came from, hence the evolutionary process. And so I actually ended up doing my PhD in computation and neural systems to learn more about natural brains, but most of my research ended up being on the evolutionary biology side of things. And I was trying to learn everything I could about evolution and how evolution produced the human brain, the one instance of real intelligence that we have. And the more I did that, the more I realized that there were so many big open questions in evolutionary biology, and it brought me back to the computational side of things in trying to answer these big evolutionary questions, right? And so since then, my research really has been focused on the question of how is evolution so open-ended? How do so many varied and complex things come out of it? And there are many different ways that I'm going to be referring to open-ended evolution. The one aspect is that new survival strategies can regularly appear in a truly open evolving system. So I mean, you can see all sorts of different defense mechanisms that might exist. For example, all right. So there's this idea of novelty that an open-ended evolving system will be generating continuous novelty. There's the idea of unbounded increases in complexity. As evolution goes on, new, more complex things keep arising. And so, starting with like eye spots to nautilus eyes, to compound eyes, to vertebrate eyes, right? I mean, and not that all these evolved from one another, but evolution kept producing more and more complex eye structures, for example. And I should note, I am very much oversimplifying many of these, but there's the idea of more and more complex survival strategies appearing. Then there's also the idea of continuous construction of new niches, new ways to survive that coexist with what's already there, new niches opening up. So for example, if you have trees, if you have plants, you end up having decaying matter to create a niche for fungi. This is a gross oversimplification. And then you have fungi, and you might have things like leaf cutter ants come around that grow fungal gardens. They go out and get leaves, and cut them up for the fungal gardens. And these are actually an incredible eusocial species. So there are many, many different roles that different ants take within a single colony. Then there are things like these flies, and actually this is not the scale, the fly is much smaller than the ant, that will come down and lay eggs on the ant's head so that when the eggs hatch, they will burrow in and eat the ant. Which is obviously not good, which creates a new, new type. The leafcutter ants then have a new type of guard ant that rides around on the leaf being carried by the leafcutter ant in order to guard it. But there's role after role, and actually I love leafcutter ants in particular because they have so many roles in their societies. I'll come back to them later. But just the idea that every time there's something else, it also creates a new niche for yet another thing. And then one of the most fascinating questions in terms of an open-ended evolving system is changes in what it means to be an individual. And so most of these are classified as major evolutionary transitions, where you might have molecular-based individuals, and many of these come together, and then you have cellular-based individuals, and then cells come together, and you have multicellular-based individuals, and multicellular-based individuals come together, and you could have eusocial colonies. And this is, again, just leaving out many steps, but just this idea that things can come together and what it means to be an individual can change over evolutionary time. So these are all fascinating aspects of evolution, but the real questions all lie in how does this work, and how can we duplicate these phenomena to study them in laboratory settings, in computers, in whatever setting? How can we really conduct experiments on any of these topics and many others? And these are all things that we really need to understand. I mean, if we want to use evolution from an applied sense as a constructive force. So the problem is, of course, so to get back to this, is that evolution is hard to study. And the main reason that evolution is so hard to study is because you're stuck working with living organisms. Living organisms reproduce slowly. So here's a whole bunch of different types of living organisms that take between hours and decades for single generations to go by. And there are ways of studying each of these. When we're talking hours or weeks, it's more reasonable to do evolutionary experiments. But still, when you need tens of thousands of generations to study some simple concepts, these experiments can take a long time. So reproducing slowly is one issue. Another issue is that living organisms can be easily influenced. So, for example, if you're studying a system of in this case hyena, and they're looking at you, you could be influencing the system. And there are ways of controlling for this, but it is a very big challenge in many circumstances to make sure that you're not influencing the system on your own. Another challenge is that living organisms are fragile. So if you have a living organism that has evolved and you want to say, all right, how does this work? So you take it apart, you probably don't have a living organism anymore. All right, and granted, this Lego frog was never alive, but I really like the picture. So living organisms also interact at many different levels. And so I brought up another picture of these leafcutter ants that have all these different roles. I already mentioned the ones that go out foraging. There are the guards. There are farmers that tend the fungal gardens. There are medics that grow antibiotics to treat the fungal gardens in case there's a bacterial infection, and so on. Anyway, and then the other problem is that because these experiments are so unwieldy, it can be really challenging to not just have one system evolve, but to obtain statistically powerful replication. right? And so this is actually Zachary Blount after he finished an experiment in Rich Lenski's experimental evolution lab that involved all the petri dishes in the towers behind him over the course of a little over a year. That was a particularly impressive experimental evolution project. So what can we do to overcome these challenges? And obviously this is an extremely leading question. The direction I'm obviously going in is a computational one, where if only we had digital organisms that we could be studying, we could throw more computing power at things if we needed to go faster, if they're going too slow. We don't have to worry about influencing them or breaking them, because when we look at the system, we can read the bits and make sure we don't change a single bit, that nothing that we do feeds back into the system. So we're not going to break them. We're not going to influence them. And the interactions at many different levels still pose a challenge, but at least we have all of the data there that we can sift through. And as far as being unwieldy for statistically powerful replication, what we're able to do is, you know, get a very large compute cluster, start up a whole bunch of runs, and tell it to email you when it's done, you know, rather than hiring an army of students to work in a wet lab for years on end. So digital organisms. There are many different ways of thinking about digital organisms. One way is to think about evolutionary computation, although evolutionary computation is very useful, but is very focused on problem solving. If we want to learn about evolution as a process, we need some kind of open-ended system, like I was describing before, where organisms can interact and alter their environments, where we can see all these different levels build up. And the first notion of digital organisms actually arose out of the computer game Core War. Right? How many of you have heard of Core War? Okay, good number. That's bigger than my audiences recently usually have. So Core War is a computer game where the players write programs that are put into the core memory of the computer. All the programs start up and try and shut each other down. Last program standing wins. So it's basically a gladiatorial arena for computer programs. It's actually a lot of fun. I actually highly recommend it. Here's a picture from an old DOS version of Core. If you look at these programs in Core War, what you'll see is that the most successful ones have one trait in common, and that is that they have the ability to self-replicate. Right? That is, they're, in addition to whatever else they're doing, they're making copies of themselves in memory. So if the main program gets shut down, all the copies are still there to continue on the fight. Right? So obviously, this is a very successful strategy, and it immediately looks like it immediately evokes the idea of an organism because it's copying itself, right? Except there was no real evolution to speak of in Core War, because there was no source of variation. This is in a computer. When a program copies itself, it was making identical copies, and you don't get evolution unless you have a source of variation. So in 1990, Steen Rasmussen, who I believe a lot of this work was done here at SFI, built Venus and a system that he referred to as Core World, where he introduced mutations into the system. He made it so that the copying process was imperfect. And he was actually able to see some stable cooperative code structures, but wasn't able to keep going with proper self-replication over long terms. The systems didn't hold up well on that front, but he launched this whole idea and was able to learn a lot about these sorts of dynamic systems. In talking with Tom Ray, who at the time was at the University of Delaware, I believe, but was visiting Santa Fe, and so from what I've heard, this conversation actually took place here. Tom Ray turned around and took some of these ideas and built a brand new system that he called Tierra that was based on Core War, And you know, had mutations in it as a source of variation, but had a bunch of other extra features, such as the organisms couldn't directly write over each other. They had a request space that they would that would be allocated for them. And so they weren't able to break each other quite so easily, which actually allowed this to be a very successful evolving system. Here's an image. So tamaracism was called Tierra. Here's an image from the Tierra system, and this is just a snapshot of memory. And you would read this like you would read a book. So when you run off the end of one line, comes on the other. This is just the memory of the virtual computer in the Tierra system, where each segment here represents a digital organism, and they're color coded. Where if two organisms have the same color, it means that they have the same genome under the same underlying program. All right. So what Tom Ray did was he started this system off with a very simple 80-line long program. What this program did was it had a pattern at its beginning and its end. So it would search for the pattern at its beginning, figure out where its beginning was in memory, search for the pattern at its end, figure out where the end is. Now that it knows where it begins and ends in memory, it can do a little bit of math, knows how long it is, allocates that much space, and then enters a copy loop. And what the copy loop does is it copies the first line, checks to see if it's done. Obviously, it's not because it's 80 lines long. Moves on to the second line, copies it, third line, fourth line, all the way down until all 80 lines are copied. And then the program issues a divide command, and the offspring gets placed gets its own CPU, and gets to start running. And so Tom Ray started this up, and it rapidly filled up memory. I believe this snapshot was taken shortly after memory was filled up on this particular run. During this copying process, every time one of these instructions were copied, there was a chance of, actually no, he didn't do it during copying. I'm sorry, I'm saying that wrong. Every time, as these runs went on, he actually just had mutations raining down on them. So while the programs were in there, bits could be flipped anywhere in the program. So this was interesting. So it started filling up, and he saw two different interesting evolutionary dynamics pick up right away. One of them was that he saw shorter and shorter programs coming around. So you know, it started with an 80-line long program, then a 70-line long program would appear and sweep and take over, then a 78-line long program would sweep and take over, and so on. And this made sense because they were doing little tweaks, little optimizations, and the shorter a program was, the less it had to copy, and so the more copies it could make in the same amount of time. So it was going to be evolutionarily more fit. And this was great, and the programs were able to shrink down that way to about 65 lines long. Losing a total of about 15 lines, one or two lines at a time. The other thing that happened that was a little bit more shocking is that a 45-line long program appeared and started to take over memory. Before it managed to take over memory, it started dying out, though. Before it died out completely, it started taking over. Right? And it would oscillate back and forth, never quite dying out, never quite taking over. And it turned out what was going on in this Tierra system was that parasites had evolved. Right? So what these programs were doing, they looked the same as the ones that they had evolved from initially, in that they would find a pattern at the beginning, find the pattern at the end, calculate their length, allocate space. But instead of having a copy loop, they went and searched for another nearby organism that had a working copy loop and used its copy loop instead. When they killed off all the fully working organisms, guess what? They were no longer able to replicate themselves and would start dying out again. So there were some really interesting dynamics. Here's a shot with a lot more parasites. The yellow ones here are parasites. The red are the longer ones. And this system had all sorts of other really interesting dynamics just spontaneously arise. So, for example, they had the parasites and the hosts would were evolving back and forth, where the hosts would evolve ways to hide their copy loops. The parasites would find ways to get into the new copy loops, things like that. When suddenly, a 78-line-long program appears and wipes everyone else out. You know, so the 65-line-long hosts, the 45-line-long parasites, all get wiped out by the 78-line-long program. What it did was not only did it hide its copy loop, It laid traps for the parasites, so when a parasite tried to jump into it, it would reroute the parasite and make the parasite copy it instead. So not only was it copying itself, it had an army of parasites copying it. All right, and yeah, here are some blue hyperparasites, whatever. So this work in the Tierra system is what really inspired me to, I initially worked a little bit with Tierra and then shifted over to building my own system. And so this was the direct inspiration for the Evita system and the digital evolution research that we do there. So in Evita, just like Tierra, so digital organisms are computer programs that self-replicate and can evolve to thrive in a noisy computational environment. So it has many of these same benefits where there are rapid generations, it's completely observable, it's easy to scale up experiments, but we tried to build the system so that we were able to create much more complex environments where we'd be able to have resources in the environment, we'd have actual two-dimensional environments, that they weren't just floating in memory, and organisms in many of our experiments will actually even move around these environments and have to navigate, et cetera. And we're trying to build a system that exhibits many of these aspects of open-ended evolution. And so that's where much of my research has been in recent years. Now, to give you a little bit more of an idea of what's going on under the hood, I can step you through one of these a little bit about one of these digital organisms. So what you see here is the simplified genome of one of these organisms, where there's a series of instructions that can be executed by a virtual CPU. And there's a whole range of different types of virtual CPUs we use. This is a depiction of the simplest of them, where there are three registers that can hold numbers that can be operated upon, stacks that can store numbers for a longer term, there are input and output buffers. There's other things like a read head and a write head that I'm not showing yet. And there's an instruction pointer that says which instruction should be executed next. So when an instruction is executed, it gets loaded into the virtual CPU, and this is an input, so when it gets executed, it pulls a number from the environment and inputs it by default into the BX register, and then moves on to the next position in the genome, where there's a pop instruction. Pop will pull a number from the active stack. In this case, because the pop is followed by a nop A, the nop A doesn't do anything by itself, but can modify other instructions. That says that it should pop into the AX register. That might have been a number that it had input previously. And then we'll skip over the nop A because it doesn't do anything. Add will add two numbers together and from A and B, put the result in C. Output will, by default, grab the CX register and output it back into the environment. And in this case, it would get flagged for having done addition if two of the numbers it took in, it summed together and output the result. Now, obviously, addition is a fairly trivial task for them to do. But it shows you the concept of we can look at what numbers they take in, what numbers they output, and using that measure what sort of functionality they have. All right, let's zoom out a little bit. So the digital organism will continue executing code. Sometimes it might hit a jump instruction that causes it to jump forward or backward some number of steps. Eventually, it will enter a copy loop, and the copy loop will copy the instructions in the genome one instruction at a time until the entire genome is copied and it has ways of identifying when it's done copying. And then the offspring gets put into a neighboring grid cell on a lattice. So each organism exists on a single grid cell. Even when it's producing an offspring, that offspring exists in the same grid cell with it until it issues a divide, and then that goes into a neighboring grid cell. And the underlying genetic language that is used here is a Turing-complete language. It's a very flexible language, so they can perform a very wide range of operations fairly easily. Now, once the offspring gets put into another grid cell, both of these start executing the next generation and will be copying themselves. In this case, you notice one of them actually had a mutation when it was producing its offspring. And like Tierra, we color code we color code by various things. We will usually color code by genome, and thus when there's a mutation, we will assign the mutant a different color. And for the most part, we abstract out the actual digital organisms, and so we'll normally be looking at grids that look like colorful grids. All of that was mostly to make clear there's a lot going on behind these colorful grids. It's not just a simple cellular automata or anything along those lines. And we can do all sorts of comparisons here to the sorts of work that's done in more traditional experimental evolution. So this example is a pair of competition experiments that we take two different types of organisms. There's the ones that are going to use yellow-greenish colors up there. Here we're going to use blue to purple colors, and we start out these two populations identically. But one group of organisms was involved in one type of environment. The other group was evolved in a different environment. Right? So what happens when they compete in the environment that the yellow organisms were evolved in? Not surprisingly, the yellow ones can reproduce faster. And we can watch them outcompete the blue ones. All right. And just to tell you what the actual difference between these environments are, it was actually the mutation rate. Yes.
You can look at the empirically what happens and maybe say some things, but nobody's going to sit down and solve those dynamic equations. So what is your criteria for how you choose your instruction set?
Absolutely. So I actually have done a number of studies on the underlying instruction sets, as have many other people. The representation used for these organisms, and so instruction sets are actually even just one possible representation. Will affect evolution in certain aspects of evolution quite a bit, and certainly the rate of adaptive evolution and the simplicity of certain possibilities over others absolutely are affected by the underlying instruction set, which is one reason that it's very important to look at lots of different examples of how evolution progresses in these different systems. So the way I see things, these artificial life systems sit at a place between mathematical modeling and natural biological systems or laboratory versions thereof. And what I mean by that is that they're much more transparent, it's much easier to collect data than it is on the laboratory systems. However, it has many more of the natural phenomena just inherently built in there than is tractable to do with pure mathematical modeling. And so what we often find is when we do experiments in these digital organisms, one of the main contributions of those experiments are that it informs in both directions, right? It lets us know what we should be looking for in the biological experiments so that we can really fine-tune those and don't waste a year doing something that's less likely to turn out to be informative, as well as helps inform from a mathematical perspective what other aspects we might want to be including that we were making assumptions that we didn't need on the mathematical side. So a big part of this is just generating the real intuition for what's going on. But I'll argue that's also not all of it. So life on Earth as we have it is all DNA and RNA based, right? And there's one aspect of that biology is about understanding life on Earth. And then that's great. You need to focus on DNA and RNA based life. But there's the other aspect that evolutionary biology should go far beyond just the limitations that DNA and RNA with the entire developmental process, et cetera, as it is, that is one instance, that is one representation that has its own limitations to it. And if we want to understand evolution beyond just limiting ourselves what happens to the specific instance on Earth, we need to be creating these other systems. Although, as John Maynard Smith pointed out, it's a much more reasonable alternative than going out into space and searching until we find independent origin life forms. Right? If we want to really generate generalizations about how living systems work, we need to use these artificial ones as well. So, anyway, does that...
There's
a
question.
Yes.
So, I don't understand your response to David's question. I think it's important to use non-DNA or RNA-based systems to study evolution, but I think biologists among us who still have an easier time understanding the motivation. Let me put it this way. There's many, many different kinds of instruction sets or architectures of digital organisms that you could have chosen
yes.
that fulfill all the criteria that you mentioned.
Yes.
Why was this particular one chosen?
So it's even hard to say that a particular one was chosen, because even within Avida, there's many different ones that you can choose for a particular experiment. And so I think the more general question is, which one should you choose? And that is a challenging question. In many cases, you should choose more than one, right? If you're really looking for generalizations, you should be looking at multiple very different ones and using very different ancestors and that sort of thing. The instruction sets that we've created, that we did a lot of experimentation on to see what effects do they have in different types of environments, right? So if we're trying to evolve navigation strategies, which instruction sets are going to be best at that? If we're trying to evolve, just raw mathematical functions, which ones are going to be the best to use there? And the default instruction sets we set up are the ones that seem to be the most well-rounded, that do a good job in as many of these different test scenarios. And so there is a strong empirical element, and then there's a strong arbitrary element of this is what we came up with and tried, and that's hard to get away from. Right. Okay. So what I was explaining the difference between these. In this case, this was an environment with a relatively moderate mutation rate. This the blues evolved in an environment with a very high mutation rate. So the yellow-green organisms here evolved to be able to perform lots of tasks and do very complex things. The blue organisms evolved to be very robust. So when we compete them in a very high mutation rate, this is actually even higher than what they first evolved in, you see that the yellow organisms are struggling a little bit, while the blue, purplish ones are spreading out, like a creeping doom across the world, and are clearly much more successful and able to handle these high mutation rates much more easily because of the level of robustness they've built into their genomes. This is just to show an example of a sort of competition experiment we can do. There's lots of other parallels with the sorts of experiments that are done in wet labs with microbial organisms. Okay, so let's see. I'm going to quickly talk about, why is this not doing anything? Oops, there we go. So about some of the early work that we did and moving it forward to some of the more recent stuff. And what I like about working with these digital organisms is that we can take some very old questions and really start exploring them. And I like to start with just a little bit of a story here about the three main challenges that Charles Darwin recognized about his theory of evolution by natural selection. And these were all challenges that were brought up by prominent contemporaries of his. And two of them were handled in the interim. So for one, Lord Kelvin was able to show by a variety of means in terms of temperatures found on the surface of the Earth, etc., that the Earth could only have been habitable for maybe 10 million years, right? Whereas Darwin felt his theory required billions of years of evolution. And it's pretty amazing to me that he was able to come up with that number of billions of years of evolution back then. But Lord Kelvin was able to show that the Earth was too hot, and that clearly 10 million years ago, the sun was engulfing the Earth, and you can't possibly have life on Earth if the sun is engulfing the Earth, because the sun's a big burning pile of coal that was being burnt down. Now, of course, in the interim, we have improved our understanding of fission and fusion, and have been able to update the habitable age of the Earth to more like 3.5 to 4 billion years, which is more in line with what Darwin believed. The second challenge was brought by Fleming Jenkin, who noted that since children were a blend of their parents, because at the time everyone believed in blending inheritance, that variations must decline over time, according to Darwin's theory, and that you might have offspring that have qualities of one parent or the other parent, but you're never going to get anything truly new. And then with that, of course, in 1900, Mendel's work was rediscovered and reconciled with Darwin's theory, and this issue was laid to rest. And actually, an interesting story is apparently Mendel's paper was found on Darwin's desk after Darwin died, still sealed, having never been looked at. Which sounds all sounds not quite ironic, but sounds like a sad story. Of course, there were apparently thousands of other papers also on Darwin's desk, still sealed. So it's not too surprising. And the third one, which is still brought up today by intelligent design creationists, is that Darwin recognized that his theory had trouble explaining the origin of complex features, which he referred to as origins of extreme perfection and complication. And so clearly, this brings up the whole idea of how does complexity arise, and more importantly, how does it get so complex where it seems like no simpler forms could have existed on a pathway to this level of complexity. Well, Darwin had some very good responses to this challenge. And actually, this challenge was put forth primarily by St. George Mivart, who also has an interesting, at the time, who also has an interesting story behind him, in that he wrote a book called On the Genesis of Species in response to On the Origin of Species, where he laid out these arguments. But he was a practicing scientist and a practicing Catholic, and he ended up getting kicked out of Oxford for his religious beliefs and excommunicated from the Catholic Church for his scientific beliefs. So he was a rather dramatic, had a rather dramatic life. But he was, at the time, actually quite well respected in the scientific community, which is why these challenges were ones that Darwin spent a lot of time on. But Darwin's response to Mivart was that in considering transitions of organs, it is so important to bear in mind the probability of conversion from one function to another. In other words, it's not that a particular function had to evolve from a simpler form to a more complex form. It is possible that something evolved complexity for one reason and then was converted to do something else. So, for example, historically, we used to have a much more complicated jaw structure that started becoming sound sensitive, or our fishy ancestors did. Because it started becoming sound sensitive, it was useful for, detecting those vibrations turned out to be very useful and ended up evolving into the bones in our ear, which is the evolutionary origin of hearing. But the original complexity wasn't there for hearing. It was there due to the jaw structure. Similarly, Darwin hypothesized that different kinds of modification would serve for the same general purpose. The point he was making here was that we only see what actually evolved, but there could have been many, many, many ways for a particular solution to a problem to have evolved, right? And as long as in aggregate they're of reasonable probability, it's okay if any one of them seems highly unlikely. So many ways of solving a problem, and then conversion of one task to another. So when we tried to look at these issues in Evita, we started with looking at the conversion of one function to another, and we did a couple of Evita treatments, right, where we call them reward and reward all and control. In the reward all treatment, we rewarded 9 different Boolean logic operations. So these are bitwise Boolean logic functions. These are mathematical functions where there were 9 different ones of them. These are the names of the functions. The bottom one, the equals, is the most complex of these, and that's we can mathematically show that because they only have NAND gates to work with, this is the one that requires the most NAND gates. All right? And so in the reward all environment, all 9 of these were rewarded for them to perform. In the control environment, only one of these, the most complex equals, was rewarded. And we did 200 populations. We ran 200 populations of each of these in some recent experiments. And we looked at how many of them managed to evolve the equals task, with the idea that if building blocks were important, they would be able to evolve the simpler tasks first, use those simpler tasks as building blocks for the complex task. And as such, we would expect the first group to evolve the complex trait more frequently. And indeed, when we looked at the results, 67 of the 200 runs we did in the first group got the complex equals task. 0 of the 200 in the when the simpler tasks weren't rewarded made it to equals, clearly showing the value of having some forms of building blocks. And I mean, clearly that's significant, but you know, just to put up the p-value, 10 to the less than 10 to the minus 20. And I'll actually even say these were run originally these were run for 100,000 updates in Evita, which is about 17,000 generations. We ran both of these even for 10 times as long, and we got many more that got equals up there, but it was still 0 down here. So this is all interesting, but what can we say about the process? What was actually going on behind the scenes here? And for that, we went back to what Darwin had to say about this, which was that in searching for the gradations through which an organ in any species has been perfected, we ought to look exclusively to its lineal progenitors. But this is scarcely ever possible when we are forced to look at other species and genera. In other words, if you wanted to see how a complex trait evolved, the best thing to do would be to start looking back through time, looking at its parents, their parents, so on, all the way back through time, until you find the first organism that had the trait, whose parents did not have the trait, what happened, right? And he points out that this is scarcely ever possible, but conveniently, with digital organisms, it is possible. So jumping back to what we're doing with the digital organisms, we can actually track evolution over time, you know, with every organism that's born. So I'm going to shrink this down. We're going to represent the organisms just as a simple circle. And we're going to keep count of how many mutations have occurred since the original ancestor and what generation we're on in the population. So this is the ancestor. It'll produce some offspring over its lifetime, some of which will have mutations, some of which won't. And every time there's a mutation, we're going to be moving it up on here to indicate that more mutations have occurred. So this one had a neutral mutation, which means that both of these should be producing about the same number of offspring, right, for the next generation, with some new mutations sometimes occurring. Let's say this one got a lethal mutation. That means it will not, in fact, be producing any more offspring, but all of these should still be producing offspring. All right. Now, this one maybe got a beneficial mutation here. And for the sake of illustration, we're going to assume this is an extremely beneficial mutation. So it's going to get most of the offspring in the next generation, right? So almost all came from that one. And then as we move on from there, we'll see that these more fit organisms take over. And we can track through time every organism What's going on there? So if we do this for an actual Vita run, these axes are the same, though obviously much larger. So what I'm going to show you on the y-axis is still the number of mutations that have occurred since the original ancestor. And along the x-axis is how many generations have gone by. And so if we draw this out, this is now a heat map. So the white areas have a ton of organisms, yellow have a good number, red have fewer, and black have none. We can look at a population over time as mutations accumulate. We can spot where you see these sudden shelves that clearly a beneficial mutation occurred right there, wiped out everything below it, and spread from there. So we can isolate a lot of characteristics of runs. These graphs we found give a good gestalt feeling for what happened during a run. But then we can dig back in. So we can look at the final dominant genotype at the end. By dominant genotype, I just mean the genotype most abundant in the population. And then trace back, so I'm drawing a blue line on there now, trace back from that end point all the way to the beginning of taking that final organism, who is its parent? Who is its parent? Who is its parent? All the way back through time. So we have the perfect line of descent from the original ancestor out to the most abundant organism in the derived population. All right? And now we can examine that line of descent and see what's going on along it. So if we take one of these organisms, we could straighten it out, and we can start looking. If that was the ancestor, we can look generation by generation, see every mutation that occurred along a specific line of descent. We can line these up a little better. So these are along the line of descent, and you know, we're numbering the generations there. And now if there are a set of traits that we're interested in, a set of phenotypic traits, we can, for any particular trait, we can say, does each organism have the trait, right? And so I'm marking a bunch of these don't have the trait, and look, it evolved in over here, but then it was lost again, and then re-evolved. Seems strange that if this was a beneficial trait, it would lose it. But if we start looking at other traits, we'll see, but if trait two were a more valuable trait, what happened is it used it perhaps as a building block for trait two. But since much of it was still there, it was able to re-evolve the functionality later. Right? And so these are the sorts of analyses we'll often do over a lineage to be able to really understand what mutations were associated with what phenotypic changes in the line of descent. We can also take a particular organism and look at that organism, right? So if this were an organism, we can look at the particular instructions in the genome, and we can start, and this is just the first part of a genome. This organism is actually much longer than this. We can start saying, all right, how important are each of these instructions to a phenotypic trait? All right. And what we can, one of the ways that we can do that is we can say, all right, let's consider a trait, the logic operation not, right? I'm listing not up here. What happens if we knock out an instruction? What happens to the performance of not? And so if it's white over here, nothing happens. If it's red, that means it lost the ability to perform not. All right? So this gives us a nice tool to say, all right, this IO here was clearly important for not. Because if we knock out that IO, it no longer performs the not function. And we can look at all nine of the logic tasks in the experiments I was just telling you about. Along the top there, it shows which ones the organism actually does. So it does not once, or not twice, or once, and so on. It doesn't do NAND or AND in this particular organism. And for each of these columns, we could see which instructions, when they are knocked out, will cause a particular trait to be lost. And so we can see that this organism performs equals. This is the first half of the organism. We can jump down to the second half of the organism. In the second half here, at the bottom, I just put a count of how many instructions were associated with a particular task. And I also mark line 46 here. So it turns out, on a particular line of descent, this was the very first organism to be able to perform equals. There was one difference between it and its parent. That was at line 46. There was a mutation. The parent was actually able to perform the AND task. So you notice you knock out line 46, it's able to perform it again, but was not able to perform equals. What's really interesting about this is from the very first moment that it's able to perform equals, 35 instructions are involved in performing equals. So it lost a task as one of its building blocks, but it gained the ability to perform equals, and many of the other sites are aligned with other tasks that it is able to keep performing. So when we studied all of these, we're able to say that in 59 of the 67 cases, a function was lost either in conjunction with acquiring equals or immediately before acquiring equals. In other words, a function was lost that was used as a building block toward equals, and so this whole building block idea has a lot of support. But what was also interesting is that all of the critical mutations were unique, as were the solutions discovered. All right? So Darwin is, of course, correct with both of these ideas. And you know, first, that environments select for traits of lesser complexity strongly predispose the evolution of more complex functions. And natural selection leads populations down many different pathways, right? Every solution found was unique, always finding new solutions to problems. So these were both true. Let's see, I have about 8 minutes, well, plus including questions. What? Yeah, so I'm just going to do one more quick thing, and then I will wrap up, which is, thus far, I just focused on raw complexity, I didn't get into any of the ecological angles, and I think I just want to touch on the ecological angles, which is to say, for these traits that are rewarded, what if, instead of always rewarding them, we associate them with a limited resource? So on the right-hand side here, I'm showing how much of each resource is available in a population. And this is going to be treated like a chemistat, which is to say resources flow in over time, so these would go up, but some fraction of what's there flow out, so they can technically reach almost 10,000 if the resources are not being used by the population. So if I start this up, what we see is that the resources very, very quickly fill up. Wow, you can't see the organisms on there at all. On my screen, you could definitely, there are organisms. You'll see that as some of them start evolving the ability, in this case, to use knot, the knot drains down, but the organisms using knot can only be in a small portion of the population because they've run out of the resource that they use. They're still spending the CPU cycles or not, but have run out of the resource. Now you'll see some of the other resources are starting to be used. And just by having limited resources, it turns out that we can have far more diverse populations, and it keeps getting more and more diverse as different niches are invaded with these different resources. And I'm just gonna keep jumping. And if we look at these, these phylogeny visualizations, we'll see that there are multiple stable coexisting branches going on. So this is the same as the graph I showed before, where we look at mutations since ancestor and generations. So they give the one before had one niche being filled. This, you can see there are multiple niches being filled. There's actually a niche invasion that happens here, where the top one, the middle one rather, splits into two. And just to wrap this up, one of the other interesting things we're able to see is that these are the runs we did before. We did another set of 200 runs with these limited resources. Now our idea is that limited resources up the diversity substantially in the population, right? So there's many different types of coexisting organisms, and they make the trade-offs easier, because if you're jumping into using a resource that no one else is using, and to do that you lose a resource that everyone else is using, so there's barely any of it, that's going to be a nice easy trade-off, right? So we thought, okay, this should help a little bit. I expected to get a little bit more than 67 out of 200. So all other conditions the same. Any guesses on how well they did? I was actually really shocked. Oops. So there's the runs, depletable resources, 200 populations, 167 out of 200 made it to getting equals, where all conditions were completely identical, except we depleted the amount of resources that were there as they got used. So, I could jump through analyses of why all that worked. It turns out that both of those factors, the diversity and the easy trade-offs are valuable. And I have a bunch of stuff about parasites and navigation. I put way too much in this. I'll just jump to acknowledgments. So lots of people have been involved in various Evita projects, and because I had a bunch of them here, I'm just listing many people on here to acknowledge, and lots of funding sources. I mean, NSF, which funded Beacon, but has funded many other projects. Northrop Grumman has actually given us a number of gifts to keep this work going. We had a DARPA grant on the fundamental laws of biology for a long time. Templeton Foundation funded parts of this, but mostly focused on evolution of cooperation. And there's lots of other projects. I'll leave it on here. Thank you all for listening. And I'll also be around for the next couple of days. So. Yes?
To what extent have you, maybe on this list somewhere, I'm getting a chance for you to do it, to what extent have you thought about how you would represent epigenetics in your framework? Because, of course, the fourth major set of challenges to Darwin come from Lamarck, and those have enjoyed renewed interest in biomedicine in the last five to 10 years.
Right. So as far as epigenetics goes, there are many possible ways of representing it. Inasmuch as we will often have these, since it's asexual, Evita can be set up so that when a cell divides, it just breaks apart into two cells that can each have partial state of the original cell. So there, from an asexual perspective, there's some natural epigenetics in there. I will say that epigenetics has turned out to be very important, because at one point we were experimenting with some communication stuff that they didn't seem to be using, but they were solving all sorts of problems anyway, and it turned out we weren't clearing the register we were using for communications for the next generation, and so effectively creating an epigenetic transfer of information that they were able to use extremely effectively. But we haven't really done much directly investigating epigenetics here. Thank you for the leading question. Yes. So the second to last one on here really starts going there. So I've been spending the last few years rebuilding Evita from scratch in my copious spare time. I'd realized I'd barely done any programming in like 8 to 10 years, and I got full professor, and I'm like, nope, that's it. I'm going to spend time every single day working on this. And for the last 3 years, I've not missed a day where I put in at least 15 minutes to working on the next version of Evita. One of the big things I really want to do is make the software extremely accessible to people, both scientists who really want to be able to modify the software so that you could easily build plugins to add new features you need, all the way to citizen scientists who haven't done any real science before and just want to be able to load them up. So the new version can be compiled either, that's still, we're not there yet, it will be out in the next year is my thought, hopefully sooner, I just don't want to promise sooner. It will be compiled natively, and it's currently clocking in at about 10 times faster than the previous version of Evita, mostly because I didn't have hundreds of different features that can all be turned on at the same time, and so it has to be testing all these different things, right? You plug in when you want new features. And it can be compiled to the web, and the current benchmarks on the web version is 5 to 6 times faster than the previous native version was. So, I'll talk a little bit about this just because it's so awesome. The Mozilla Foundation has put out a new compiler called mscripten that will compile from C++ to high efficiency JavaScript that is on the order of 10 times faster than what a JavaScript expert could write in JavaScript. So, I mean, these are so it's now possible to just write just lightning fast web apps, and so we're using a lot of this technology for the next version of Evita, and we're going to try and build it so that anyone who wants to sit down and use the software can very easily. And it's coming along beautifully. I've been working on it for a few years now. Most of the big pieces are there, and we're just putting them together and getting the user interface going. So, and I guess I could show pictures.